Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of The Summer of 1787. The Men Who Invented the Constitution by David O. Stewart. Narrated by George K. Wilson. This book is copyrighted 2007 by David O. Stewart. This recording is copyrighted 2007 by Recorded Books. Relying on the words of the delegates themselves to explore their sharp conflicts and hard bargaining, David O. Stewart takes us back to the Philadelphia Convention of 1787 and lays out the passions and contradictions of the often painful process of writing the Constitution of the United States. It was a desperate balancing act. Revolutionary principles required that the people have power, but could the people be trusted? Would a stronger central government leave room for the states? Would the small states accept a Congress in which seats were allotted according to population, rather than to each sovereign state? And what of slavery? In a country continually arguing over the document's original intent, it is fascinating to watch these powerful characters struggle toward consensus, often reluctantly, to write a flawed but living and breathing document that could evolve with the nation. And now? The summer of 1787.
Chapter 1. It started at Mount Vernon. March 1785. Snow was falling outside as George Washington mulled over the problem with his neighbor, George Mason. A fire in the west parlor, where the Washingtons entertained guests, pushed back the night chill. Both men favored sweet Madeira wine in the evening, and Mount Vernon's house slaves made sure they had everything they wanted. Dedicated farmers, the men talked easily of the cold weather that would delay spring planting, and of the grafts Mason recently sent for Mount Vernon's cherry trees. On the other side of the mansion, the wide lawn sloped down to the Potomac, which curved gracefully between Maryland and Virginia on its journey from the western mountains. The river was the problem. The two states were fighting over it, and their argument was a symptom of the deepening crisis of the new United States. Washington, 7 years younger than his guest, had earned an honest fatigue during a day on horseback, supervising work around his plantation. Mason, though, knew only the jangling irritation that follows a day of impatient waiting. They had been friends for almost 40 years, spending days and nights in each other's homes. Together they had hunted for deer, talked politics, hosted dancing schools, shared farming strategies, and schemed to develop the Potomac as a center of trade. Both were local leaders, serving as vestrymen for Truro Parish and trustees of the city of Alexandria. Each, in his own way, had led the rebellion against Great Britain. In 1774, Washington had presided over the county convention that adopted the Fairfax Resolves, which Mason had drafted in that same parlor at Mount Vernon. Mason's aggressive resolves proclaimed that imposing British laws on Americans without their consent violated the privileges of a free people and the natural rights of mankind. Washington went on to personify the American Revolution with his moral and military leadership, while Mason played a more local role through Virginia's General Assembly. By different paths, they each had reached a stage in life where he had many admirers, not so many friends. Each now described himself as retired. The firelight exaggerated the contrasts between them. Known to crack walnuts with a single large hand, The strongly built Washington had thrived on outdoor living and battlefield dangers. At 53, he retained the grace and power of a superb horseman and dancer. But it was something from the inside that made him the master of every room he entered. Certainly, he was a Virginia gentleman of courtesy and integrity, but so were others. Equally, he had his flaws, including being addicted to gambling, avid in the pursuit of wealth, a most horrid swearer and blasphemer, and unrelentingly ambitious. Washington's force came from the antagonistic qualities he blended. His gift of taciturnity radiated dignity and calm, yet he simultaneously implied, in the words of one admirer, "passions almost too mighty for man." No one who saw Washington's rage ever forgot it. The combination of steely discipline and powerful drive generated a charisma so compelling that, by one account, every king in Europe would look like a valet de chambre by his side. The leader of a successful rebellion against the world's greatest empire, he was the first citizen of the American continent, an international figure. Mason, just 60, was small and erect, with clear gray eyes and few white hairs. A man of thought, he wrote Virginia's Declaration of Rights in early June of 1776. When Thomas Jefferson assembled the Declaration of Independence later that month, he borrowed large portions from Mason's document, though the older man's effort was largely forgotten. Subject to painful gout, and often reluctant to leave his Gunston Hall estate, Mason was blunt and sarcastic, where Washington was guarded and tactful. Once, Mason had been viewed as a mentor to Washington, who was a teenager when they first met, but that time was long past. During the war, Washington had been exasperated when the older man stayed in Virginia rather than pitch in to the national effort. "Where are our men of abilities?" he wrote to Mason. "How do they not come forth to save their country? Let this voice, my dear sir, call upon you." But because of Mason's illnesses, because he was a widower with 9 children on whom he doted, because he simply preferred staying close to home, he did not heed that call. Still, Washington relied on Mason for help with intimate matters. When snarls developed with his stepdaughter's estate or with his stepson's assets, Washington had turned to Mason for help. Only 4 months before, he had asked Mason to loan his brother John Washington £400, £500, or £600, a substantial sum. If any man could speak with the general as his peer and his friend, it was Mason. Several days before they sat in front of the fireplace at Mount Vernon, Mason had received a letter from 2 Marylanders saying they looked forward to meeting him in Alexandria. The letters stated that Mason was one of 4 Virginia commissioners with whom they were to negotiate the dispute between the 2 states over trade, as well as fishing and navigation rights on the Potomac. Mason was nonplussed. The letter said the meeting had been scheduled for weeks, but the Virginian knew nothing about it or about his appointment as a commissioner. Communication was slow in 1785. Capricious delivery arrangements made correspondence difficult. Distances were daunting as travelers floundered along bad roads and waited for unreliable ferries. Still, news of this significance should have reached Mason from Richmond, the state capital. Mason surmised that Virginia, actually Governor Patrick Henry, had neglected to notify its commissioners of their appointments and of the Alexandria meeting. Hoping for the best, Mason managed to scrounge up another Virginia commissioner, Alexander Henderson of nearby Dumfries, and joined the Marylanders at Gadsby's Tavern in Alexandria. after 3 purgatorial days waiting for the last 2 Virginians to arrive, Mason was certain they would not. The situation was maddening. Mason did not even have the resolution that established his authority. He knew that the river dispute grew from the charter for Maryland that King Charles I issued in 1632. That document defined Maryland as extending to the far bank of the river, fostering chronic conflict with Virginia over tolls and taxes and fishing. In 1785, similar squabbles were flaring among America's 13 independent, yet not quite united, states. Connecticut and Pennsylvania fought over land. New York and New Hampshire wrestled for Vermont. New Jersey assailed New York's taxes on shipping. The conflicts limited trade and all forms of economic activity. If the states were to prosper, much less become a nation, they had to stop fighting each other. Appreciating the importance of the project, Mason turned to Washington, who corresponded widely and was well informed. But the general had only a resolution of the Virginia Assembly that expanded Mason's responsibilities to include negotiating with Pennsylvania over access to the Ohio River. The document shed no light on dealings with Maryland over the Potomac. In running their plantations, Mason and Washington depended on the river for access to markets in Europe and in the other states. But Washington saw it as much more. He envisioned the Potomac as a highway to the lands on the far side of the Appalachians, knitting them together with the existing communities on the East Coast. Pursuing this vision 8 months before, he had spent weeks in the wilderness searching for the best overland route between the Potomac and the Ohio River. By January 1785, he had persuaded Maryland and Virginia to charter a company, with him as its head, to develop the river. Soon crews would begin hauling rocks out of the upper river to try to create a shipping channel. After Mason joined the Maryland commissioners at the Alexandria Tavern, Washington kept an eye on the perplexing situation, even dining once with the idling commissioners. Now, on March 24th, Washington had sent his carriage to bring Mason to Mount Vernon. Sitting together on that snowy night, they knew the time for waiting was over. Either Mason would negotiate with half a delegation, and in ignorance of his instructions, or the Marylanders would go home. They had to decide what to do. They resolved that Mason should push on. To men who had helped start a revolution, Mason's lack of instructions was no reason to pass up the opportunity to achieve something important. As Mason told it later, the Marylanders had brought with them the most amicable dispositions and expressed the greatest desire of forming such a fair and liberal compact. The general's influence was pivotal, but for his activity and urgency, the conference might have been abandoned. Almost as important as Washington's encouragement was the political protection he provided. Who would challenge Mason's actions if they had been blessed by Washington? The general invited the entire conference to Mount Vernon, where the commissioners could proceed in the comfort of his hospitality. As host, Washington was reported to send the bottle about pretty freely after dinner. Though 5 unscheduled guests would tax any household, the Washingtons were better prepared than most. Mount Vernon had 9 extra bedrooms, and in 1785 accommodated overnight guests on 235 days. Neither Mason nor Washington worried that they might be violating the Articles of Confederation, the document by which the 13 states had made themselves a nation in 1781, only 4 years before. The articles barred any 2 states from entering into an agreement without the consent of Congress. But disregard for that toothless charter was rampant. Under the Articles, the government consisted only of Congress, with neither an executive branch nor courts. Worse, Congress at this time, often referred to as the Confederation Congress, frequently lacked a quorum to take official action and rarely had money to pay for any action it might take. After years of battling Congress for his soldiers' pay and supplies, Washington considered it a half-starved, limping government that appears to be always moving upon crutches and tottering at every step. The feeble Confederation Congress was no reason not to negotiate with Maryland. The next 3 days brought more harsh weather, including snow, but the general rode out every day to supervise the planting of pine trees. Inside the mansion, the feelings among the commissioners were warm. Washington's encouraging spirit infused their meetings, while the mansion offered panoramic views of the river over which they bargained. Their agreement, reached on the fourth day, declared the Potomac a common highway for citizens of both states. The states would share taxes on foreign cargoes, fishing rights, and the cost of lighthouses. Virginia promised not to impose tolls on Chesapeake Bay, though Mason discovered later that he had no authority to negotiate over the Chesapeake. Indeed, he and his fellow commissioners had no authority to proceed at all, since the Virginia Assembly had required the presence of at least three commissioners. In this blundering business, Mason later wrote to Virginia's Assembly, he hoped that forms will be dispensed with, as the compact was a good one. Mason's report to the Assembly included a key provision. He recommended that the conference with Maryland become an annual event to review other issues, such as the many forms of money then in circulation, import and export taxes levied by states, and the regulation of bills of exchange. Maryland expanded on Mason's proposal when it ratified the compact, inviting Delaware and Pennsylvania to join annual negotiations. In the Virginia Assembly, the compact was referred to a committee chaired by James Madison, one of the two Virginia commissioners who never made it to Alexandria. Madison would see in it a unique opportunity for the nation. A generation younger than the neighboring Georges, Madison, at 34, was already a seasoned politician, having served at Virginia's Constitutional Convention in 1776, and also in the Confederation Congress after adoption of the Articles in 1781. Short and barely 100 pounds, the reserved Madison cut a modest figure in the drawing room. He would not marry until his 43rd year, but on matters of public concern, Madison's intelligence and industry won respect and influence beyond his years. Madison first worked with General Washington in 1784, sponsoring the legislation to develop the Upper Potomac. Ironically, Madison also sponsored the resolution that convened the Mount Vernon Conference, though he, like Mason, was never told when it would convene. Madison had intended the conference to address only riverine disputes. Now, more than a year later, the picture was changing, and Madison's perspective was lengthening. He was convinced now that the government established by the Articles had to be replaced. The Madisons were planters on a scale with Washington and Mason, though not quite so prosperous. More than 100 slaves worked Montpelier, the estate managed by Madison's father in the Western Hills. But where the Potomac neighbors were passionate farmers, Madison's passions ran to libraries and legislatures where he could imagine and test political philosophies. He completed his studies at the College of New Jersey, later renamed Princeton, in record time, driving himself to a form of breakdown. For the rest of his life, his health anxieties would border on hypochondria, though he ultimately reached his 85th year. By late 1785, Madison recognized that individual states would never regulate commerce fairly. States with active ports could not resist taxing goods from nearby states, while their neighbors retaliated in any manner they could. When three New England states tried to win concessions from the British by restricting their trade, Connecticut undermined them by aggressively promoting its own trade with Britain. Only a national government could regulate commerce fairly, but the Confederation Congress lacked the power to do so under the Articles. Amending the Articles required unanimous agreement of the 13 state legislatures, but unanimity never seemed possible. In the spring of 1786, 12 states voted to give Congress the power to tax imports, only to see New York torpedo the measure. "Every liberal good man," one patriot wrote, "is wishing New York in hell." One idea in circulation was to call a convention of the states to write a new charter of government. The legislatures in New York and Massachusetts had adopted resolutions proposing such a convention, though the proposals had gone nowhere. Visiting Mount Vernon in October of 1785, Madison wondered whether Mason's report on the Mount Vernon Conference might pave the way to such a convention. Washington encouraged the notion. As he impatiently wrote to Madison, "We are either a united people or we are not. If the former, let us in all matters of general concern act as a nation. If we are not, let us no longer act a farce by pretending to it." Madison soon reported to Washington that Virginia might call for the states to meet to consider the requisite augmentation of the power of Congress over trade. Such a step, he added, seems naturally to grow out of the Mount Vernon Conference. By January 21, 1786, it was done. The Virginia Assembly called on the other states to send delegates to Annapolis on the first Monday in September to consider a uniform system in their commercial regulations, and appointed Madison as one of Virginia's five delegates. Arriving 8 months later at George Mann's Tavern in Maryland's capital, Madison found but two other delegates. He confided his fears to a younger brother. "Nothing can bear a worse aspect than our federal affairs. No money comes into the public treasury, trade is on a wretched footing, and the states are running mad after paper money." A few days later, Alexander Hamilton of New York, long an advocate of replacing the Articles, joined him. But only 12 delegates from five states reached Annapolis. None came from New England, called the Eastern States at that time, or from the Deep South, the Carolinas and Georgia, or even from Maryland, the host. Talking at Mann's Tavern, where rooms were a shilling a night, the 12 Annapolis delegates considered going home without even convening. Then they thought better of it. They were stout patriots, half of whom would sign the Constitution a year later. They were certainly too few to go forward, but they would not give up the game. With the same boldness that Mason and Washington had displayed the year before, they decided to play the convention card once more, this time double or nothing. They needed a pretext for this move and found it in New Jersey's direction to its delegates to address commercial issues and other important matters. The nation's problems were far from merely commercial. Other countries took advantage of America's weakness. The British occupied forts in the West and refused to trade with Americans. Spain had closed the Mississippi River to Americans. In the Mediterranean, the Barbary States seized American ships and enslaved their crews. This was no time for half measures. Why not a convention to address all of the national government's defects? Hamilton drafted a fiery call for a new convention, which Madison and others toned down. The final version soberly noted, "The embarrassments which characterize the present state of our national affairs," then urged the states to send delegates to a convention in Philadelphia, "may next to devise such further provisions that appear to them necessary to render the constitution of the federal government adequate to the exigencies of the Union." Having convened a week late, the delegates adjourned on their second day. Traveling home, the Annapolis delegates knew much had to be done for the Philadelphia Convention to succeed. Powerful supporters had to be enlisted, none more important than the retired general on the Potomac. Washington's strong-armed intervention had started the process by saving the bumbling business at Mount Vernon, and his support again would be crucial. The larger question was whether conditions were bad enough for the states to put aside their parochial interests and create a strong national government. Terrible events brewing in central Massachusetts would persuade many Americans that conditions were at least that bad. The effort to create a new government, which started in earnest when two old friends sat before a Mount Vernon fire and chose to act with no authority, would prove arduous. Change, especially fundamental change, is always painful and always inflicts casualties. In this case, one casualty would be their friendship. Chapter 2. Blood on the Snow. Winter, 1787. The cold was bitter. Horse-drawn carts crossed the wide Connecticut River over a thick layer of ice. 2,000 American rebels were marching through almost 4 feet of snow toward Springfield, Massachusetts. The farms they passed were small and struggling, but the residents freely offered food and drink. The rebels themselves were mostly farmers, not part of any formal military structure, though many had been soldiers before. Some carried old muskets. Some had only swords and clubs. The newspapers were calling it Shays Rebellion, for Daniel Shays, one of the leaders. Thrust to the fore because of his military experience, Shays was a reluctant commander, proud that so far his troops had avoided combat in this ragtag rebellion. Prominent Americans like George Washington and George Mason knew nothing of Daniel Shays, but they were learning. The men's spirits were high. They were fighting for their rights. Bundled against the winter, some wore sprigs of evergreen in their caps, symbols of their rebellion. Their grievances were many. They groaned under ancient debts made still more burdensome from an increase of interest. They were taxed too heavily, and there was little hard currency for paying taxes. The expensive court system seemed always to favor creditors, foreclosing on the property of farmers and tradesmen. They were not all poor, but the times were hard. As many as 2/3 of them had been hauled into debtors' courts, facing humiliation and even jail. For years, the government in distant Boston had turned a deaf ear to their complaints. The rebels moved in three columns, miles apart from each other. As they trudged through the severest winter in many years, their goal was the arsenal in Springfield. It held cannon, thousands of new muskets with bayonets, and 1,300 barrels of powder. The rebels had cut off the roads to the arsenal on three sides while they seized grain and meat from local merchants. Once they had the arsenal's weapons, they would be a force to be reckoned with. In a chilling ultimatum, they promised that unless the building's defenders surrendered, the rebels would give nor take no quarter. pledging to slaughter any prisoners captured in battle. Most of the 1,200 troops opposing them were their neighbors. The rebellion had begun 6 months before, during the summer of 1786, when crowds of angry farmers prevented court from convening in Northampton. Their reasoning was linear. No court hearings meant no judgments for creditors and no foreclosures. In September, while the Annapolis delegates gathered, other crowds blocked courts in Worcester, in Taunton, in Great Barrington, even in Concord, already storied as the birthplace of the Revolution. Angry debtors had closed courts in New Hampshire and Connecticut, too, but only in Massachusetts had the militia refused to oppose the unrest, sometimes even joining it. In October, Congress met in New York City, 140 miles away, to authorize the recruitment of federal troops to restore order in Massachusetts. To avoid spreading alarm about the rebellion, the congressional resolution stated that the troops would put down threats from the Shawnee, the Potawatomi, and the Chippewa. No one was fooled. Unlike the farmers of Massachusetts, those tribes were not on the warpath. It mattered little whether anyone was fooled by Congress's ruse. The 13 states refused to pay for federal troops, so only a few were recruited, then sent home. Once Congress's failure was clear, the rich men of Boston passed the hat to underwrite a state force of 4,000. With other state troops, William Shepard, a Revolutionary War veteran, defended the Springfield Arsenal. Shepard, who himself had been hauled into court for his debts, had little sympathy for the rebels. "I have lost 8 years hard service," he wrote, "to suffer frost and defend the lives and property of a set of damned rascals who are daily threatening to cut my throat." Daniel Shays led one of the three rebel columns on that snowy day in late January 1787. Surprisingly little is known about the man, including what he looked like. He enlisted as a private when the Revolutionary War began, fighting at Bunker Hill and Saratoga, as he rose to sergeant and then captain. A commander of state troops remembered him as a brave and good soldier. The Marquis de Lafayette gave him a gold sword, but Shays sold it, probably to pay expenses of his farm in Pelham in the central part of the state, where he moved after the war. Though Shays' farm was more than 100 acres, he was no more prosperous than his neighbors. In 1786, he owed money to at least 10 different creditors. Shays was a member of his town's Committee of Safety. He and his wife Abigail joined the Second Parish Church when it was incorporated in 1786. When the rebellion began, Shays declined the first command offered to him, then relented and joined his neighbors. Just a month before leading the rebels to the Springfield Arsenal, he protested that it was always against my inclination to engage in this business. But when his friends persisted, I could not withstand their importunity. The attack on the arsenal went badly. Although both sides included veteran soldiers, the state forces had artillery and better weapons. The rebels were poorly coordinated. Only two of their columns, about 1,500 men, advanced on the arsenal from the west. They marched over flat, open ground. The state troops formed a line in front of their arsenal and soldiers' barracks, cannon interspersed among them. General Shepard sent messengers to ask what the rebels wanted and to warn that he would fire on them. The rebels would not be deterred by palaver. Their officers ordered, "March on! March on!" The first cannon shot sailed over the heads of the rebels, who dropped prostrate, but instantly rose in place again soon as the balls had passed. They kept coming. Shepard finally gave the order. The artillery roared again, crashing in at waistband height. The rebels ran, outraged cries of murder in their throats. Four attackers died, and many more were wounded, flesh and blood yielding to grape shot. A ball ripped both arms off a cannoneer with the state troops who misjudged the weapon's fuse. He, too, died of his wounds. Shays tried to stop the headlong flight, but his men paid him no heed. There was not a single musket fired on either side. State troops pursued the rebel force for the next week. Bent on surprising the rebels, on the night of February 3rd, the state forces marched through a blizzard to Petersham, slogging through drifts, half leg high. According to one soldier, the wind and snow came in whirls and eddies and penetrated the all of my clothes and filled my eyes, ears, neck, and everything else. Exhausted and frozen, the state troops heaved into Petersham at 9 a.m. on a Sunday. The rebels were stunned. Outnumbered and unprepared, Shays and his men granted the state troops a peaceable entrance to the town. The rebels abandoned their provisions, some still warming over breakfast fires, along with firearms and swords. They thronged into a back road towards Athol. The state troops took their places before the fireplaces of the town. Most of the rebels went home, though the leaders lit out for Vermont, which was led by a renegade government that defied claims of New York and New Hampshire to control the area. The rebellion died with their flight, though sporadic violence continued through June. The victors had little appetite for vengeance. They hanged two captured leaders and imprisoned a score more, but most of the rebels evaded punishment. From Vermont, Shays petitioned for a pardon and received it in 1789. He made his way to Sparta, New York, where he farmed and later drew his military pension until his death in 1825. Despite the rebels' failure, their political impact was immense. 10 years after the Declaration of Independence, and not even 4 years after a victorious peace with the British, Americans were slaughtering each other on the field of battle. Neighbors warring with neighbors. Incontestable proof of political failure. The rebels raged at a state government dominated by merchants who insisted on high taxes to repay the state's war debts, then awarded seats in the state Senate on the basis of the wealth of each community. That rage, great enough to send husbands and fathers and sons and brothers into the frigid Massachusetts winter, loosed a flurry of self-examination and doubt. Henry Knox of New England wrote to Washington, his former war commander, that the rebellion wrought prodigious changes in the minds of men respecting the powers of government. Everybody says they must be strengthened. Knox's reports troubled Washington, eclipsing thoughts of retiring from public life, of devoting himself to farming and developing the Potomac as an inland waterway. From the first reports of rebellion, the hero general suffered an acute distress. "I am mortified beyond expression," he wrote in October 1786. "When I view the clouds that have spread over the brightest morn that ever dawned upon any country." A week later, he insisted that decisive action was needed. "Without some alteration in our political creed, the superstructure we have been 7 years raising at the expense of so much blood and treasure must fall. We are fast verging to anarchy and confusion." Even before the Shays Rising, the nation stitched together during the Revolution was beginning to dissolve. The national government had neither a consistent currency nor a military force, nor the power to regulate trade, nor the power to levy taxes. Shays and his neighbors provided a critical push in the effort to create a new American government. Winning independence from Britain, it turned out, was but the first step to becoming a nation. As John Adams had predicted, establishing a truly national government would be the most intricate, the most important, the most dangerous and delicate business. Americans needed to think long and hard about what sort of government would preserve their independence and their precious liberties. They needed a government that could hold the states together, develop the huge Western territories, and lead Americans to their rightful place in the world. 4 months after Americans marched into the mouths of cannon manned by other Americans, the Philadelphia Convention would meet to create that new government. In an act of inspired improvisation, it would produce the world's longest-running experiment in self-rule, 22 decades and counting. Yet the results of that gathering were far from certain. Straining to balance the conflicting needs and worldviews of the 13 states, the convention delegates would struggle with basic questions of human slavery, personal liberties, and how to structure a working democracy. The people of America would hold their breath for 4 months while the convention met, secretly, to decide their fate. Had they been able to view the confusion and conflict among the delegates, they might have lost hope altogether. Chapter 3. A House on Fire. Spring, 1787. Even before Daniel Shays led his men into the muzzles of cannon, four states had appointed delegations for the Philadelphia Convention. The bloodshed on the icy fields of Massachusetts built powerful momentum behind the convention. Who could deny the peril when thousands marched in rebellion through New England blizzards? By late February, Congress endorsed the effort. In March, Madison reported to Thomas Jefferson in France that all but three states had picked delegates for Philadelphia. Washington agonized over whether to accept appointment as a Virginia delegate. On March 28th, he sent Governor Edmund Randolph a slightly coy agreement to serve at the convention, complaining of a rheumatic complaint in my shoulder that was so bad that he could not raise my hand to my head or turn myself in bed. Washington agreed to attend if his health permitted, and no one was appointed in his place, the word of which would be highly pleasing to me. However inevitable Washington's decision may appear today, it probably was a difficult one for him. Over the winter, he had endured the death of his brother and his own illness. Having been absent from Mount Vernon for 8 years during the Revolution, another extended absence had little appeal, and for Washington, the stakes were uncommonly high. As the preeminent man in America, his every public action was noticed and interpreted. If he seemed too eager to reconstitute the government, some would see a power grab. Indeed, his prestige was so great that it could hardly be increased by a successful convention. Yet it surely would be tarnished if the convention went badly. What was so terribly wrong with the Articles of Confederation? By 1787, they had been in effect for only 6 years, during which time the Americans beat the British and turned their energies to peacetime pursuits. Did the rash acts of Massachusetts hotheads have to condemn the Articles, especially in view of that state's reputation for ill temper? Jefferson, 3,000 miles away in Paris, viewed the Shays Rising with a bemused shrug, observing that it was the only American rebellion for the last 11 years. "God forbid we should ever be 20 years without such a rebellion," he wrote. "The tree of liberty must be refreshed from time to time with the blood of patriots and tyrants. It is its natural manure." But Washington's alarmed response was far more typical, as expressed in his question to Madison. "What stronger evidence can be given of the want of energy in our government than these disorders?" After the Shays' rising, the government's weakness was visible to every American. It was weak because that was what the 13 states wanted. With their own histories and traditions, the states mistrusted each other. New Englanders and Southerners found each other's speech foreign. During the war with Britain, troops from the rest of the country tended to draw together in a common unfriendliness toward the New Englanders, resenting their leveling democracy and moral narrowness. The economic interests of the regions diverged widely. New England depended on shipping and fishing. The Middle States, New York, New Jersey, Delaware, and Pennsylvania, grew grain and had infant industries. In the South, slave-based agriculture needed export markets for tobacco from Maryland and Virginia, for rice and indigo from South Carolina. Each state tailored its tax system to its own economy. Southern states favored free trade, while the eastern states used import duties to protect industry. Political divisions followed regional lines. A Southerner wrote resentfully in January 1787 that the Yankees opposed a North Carolinian as president of the Confederation Congress, stressing, "The great extent of territory to be under one free government." One convention delegate found that in the various regions, the manners and modes of thinking of the inhabitants differ nearly as much as in different nations of Europe. Indeed, some Americans proposed to dissolve the Confederation. Southern newspapers openly discussed dividing the country into four nations: Eastern, Middle, Southern, and Trans-Allegheny. Congressional delegates from Massachusetts and Pennsylvania expected the nation would be divided. In August 1786, James Monroe, the future president, wrote from Congress in New York, "Certain it is that committees are held in this town of Eastern men and others of New York upon the subject of a dismemberment of the states east of the Hudson from the Union and the erection of them into a separate government." Monroe added, "The measure is talked of in Massachusetts familiarly and is supposed to have originated there." A North Carolinian also feared that the Confederation was no more than a rope of sand that could not prevent dissolution of the Union. 6 months later, Madison anticipated public support for a partition of the Union into three more practicable and energetic governments. For Washington and Madison, the problem with the Articles was the states. They had too much power, while Congress had far too little. Washington lamented that 13 sovereignties pulling against each other and all tugging at the federal head will soon bring ruin on the whole. Henry Knox fulminated on the subject to one convention delegate, "The state systems are the accursed thing that will prevent our being a nation. The vile state governments are sources of pollution which will contaminate the American name for ages, machines that must produce ill but cannot produce good. Smite them in the name of God and the people." In a letter written halfway through the Philadelphia Convention, Washington sputtered that the states were the primary cause of all of our disorders. Because of the states' tenacity, In clinging to power, he added, "Weak at home and disregarded abroad is our present condition, and contemptible enough it is." The government's impotence inflicted on every American twin plagues of bad money and confusing money. During the war, Congress issued millions in unsecured bills of credit, which promptly slid to such little value that the phrase, "not worth a continental," entered the idiom. By July of 1779, a continental dollar was worth 5 cents or less. In 1780, a sheep could be purchased for $150 in paper money or $2 in hard currency. Since Congress's money was worthless, the British pound was the prevailing currency, a residue of colonial times. When Madison in 1786 excoriated the states for issuing their own paper money, he expressed their currencies in pound sterling. But what was the value of a pound sterling? In Virginia, it held 1,289 grains of silver, but in Pennsylvania, only 1,031. To establish an American currency in 1785, the Confederation Congress adopted the dollar, initially a Spanish currency. But what was its value? The New England states and Virginia pegged a dollar at 6 shillings, while the Mid-Atlantic states valued it at 7 shillings and 6 pence. New York and North Carolina set the value at 8 shillings. But South Carolina and Georgia chose a value of 4 shillings and 6 pence. Transactions also might be conducted in Spanish doubloons, Prussian carolines, or Portuguese moidores or johannas. This kaleidoscope of currency allowed the states to curry favor with their citizens by issuing their own paper money, and pretending it had the same value as gold or silver specie. Madison blamed Pennsylvania and North Carolina for taking the lead in this folly. South Carolina, New Jersey, and New York followed. With its government controlled by the most democratic forces on the continent, Rhode Island went the furthest. The state issued 100,000 pounds of paper notes that by law had to be accepted on the same terms as gold. Madison wrote of the little state in horror. Supplies were withheld from the market, the shops were shut, popular meetings ensued, and the state remains in a sort of convulsion. The Virginian despaired that this fictitious money produced warfare and retaliation among the states. Monetary anarchy was not too strong a term. With different currencies of doubtful value, yet not enough hard currency, every citizen was a currency trader, and every transaction presented a risk of being cheated. When it came to political power, Congress also could not conceal its debility. The British, not deigning to send a full-rank ambassador, refused to trade with Americans, including in the West Indies, a devastating blow to American merchants. Some states persisted in charting their own foreign policies. Georgia, a frontier community with only 50,000 souls, was waging war against the Creek Indians, with neither notable success nor any involvement of Congress. Martial law prevailed in the state, and Spain, which held Florida, was suspected of arming the Creeks. Virginia separately ratified the peace treaty with Britain, while Maryland negotiated directly with the British government to recover stock it held in the Bank of England. More serious, Spain allowed no American trade through its port in New Orleans, crippling the trade of Western settlers who had to ship their goods down the Mississippi River. For a year, the Confederation Congress tried to reach agreement with Spain on this essential issue, but abandoned the talks when the Spaniards insisted on closing the river to Americans for another 25 years. The treaties the United States had signed were not respected by either side. British troops still manned forts around the Great Lakes, even though the Treaty of Paris required their withdrawal. American states ignored their obligation under the same treaty to pay Loyalists for property confiscated during the Revolution. Despite a treaty guaranteeing equal treatment for Dutch wines and brandy, Virginia granted preference to French products. Though Virginia's policy might be justified on aesthetic grounds, it was no way to thank the Dutch for loans that kept the American government afloat. The Confederation Congress fared no better in maintaining internal peace, beginning with its failure to raise troops to meet the Shays rebels. There were other examples. From Massachusetts to South Carolina, 9 states claimed to have their own navies. Western settlers proclaimed the new state of Franklin and elected a governor. Vermont functioned as a sort of free state, offering haven to Shays and his colleagues amid rumors that it might join Canada as part of the British Empire. Connecticut, in 1776, had claimed Pennsylvania's Wyoming Valley, calling it Westmoreland County, establishing courts there and receiving its representatives to the Connecticut legislature. The state lost the land claim before a national commission in 1782, but fighting erupted 2 years later when Pennsylvania moved to assert power over the valley. In recompense, Connecticut was granted the Western Reserve in what is now northern Ohio. And what of trade, the issue that drove the Virginia-Maryland Compact? States that were blessed with thriving ports, Massachusetts, New York, Pennsylvania, South Carolina, happily taxed any shipment on the way to or from bordering states. Forced to subsidize those states with good ports, the neighbors could only gnash their teeth. Madison later wrote that New Jersey, placed between Philadelphia and New York, was likened to a cask tapped at both ends, and North Carolina, between Virginia and South Carolina, to a patient bleeding at both arms. To retaliate, New Jersey formed its own customs service, taxed the lighthouse for New York Harbor on Sandy Hook, and refused to provide funds to a Confederation Congress that did not help it. No state could contest Britain's trade policies, while Congress could not protect American merchants from the Barbary pirates. Rufus King, a young Massachusetts congressman who would make his mark at the Philadelphia Convention, wrote despairingly to John Adams that because of jealousies among the states, our commerce is almost ruined. Lack of revenue was the ultimate indignity for the Confederation. Congress could impose no taxes. It could only make requisitions for funds from the 13 states. Its requisitions met with very mixed results. In August 1786, after debating what to do about the 10 states that had not paid their requisitions, Congress issued an address urging payment, then dispatched members to state assemblies to plead for funds. Although the Treasury afforded a most melancholy aspect, the pleas went for naught. South Carolina paid nothing for 3 years. New Jersey and Connecticut consistently failed to meet their obligations. Georgia never paid. In truth, the lack of government revenue resulted in part from the crippling lack of currency. The states raised revenues through property taxes and poll taxes on individuals. Without enough hard money in circulation, citizens like the Shays rebels could not pay, forcing state governments either to punish non-payment or to forego revenue. Many decided to let tax collections slide and ignore Congress's need for funds. Massachusetts chose the other course and incited a rebellion. Congress seemed to grow weaker with each month. no respect is paid to the federal authority, Madison wrote. Not a single state complies with the requisitions. Several pass over them in silence, and some positively reject them. Government without revenue can scarcely go by the name. The Confederation Congress owed tens of millions of dollars on the bonds and bills it sold to fund the war against Britain. The debts festered, destroying the nation's ability to borrow again. A potent symbol of Congress's frailty was its homelessness. It fled Philadelphia in June of 1783 when mutinous troops demanded their pay, and the Pennsylvania militia was slow to provide protection. Princeton, little more than a hamlet, was Congress's next home. After a spell in Annapolis, the fugitive legislature lodged for a time in Trenton, finally coming to rest in New York City. Vagabondage is not the hallmark of a great government. The articles, which had taken 16 months to prepare, were drafted to make sure that Congress was weak and the states remained strong. In throwing off the British yoke, Americans in October 1777 refused to create another government that was superior to the states. Still, ratification of the Articles was not completed until early 1781, mostly because Maryland refused to act until Virginia relinquished its claim to own most of the Western territories. The Articles proclaimed an agreement between the states of New Hampshire, Massachusetts Bay, Rhode Island, and so on, which entered a firm league of friendship with each other. Each state retained its sovereignty, freedom, and independence, along with any power not expressly delegated to the United States. In a provision resented by large states and cherished by small ones, each cast a single vote in Congress. Thus, the Articles were a compact between the states of America, not a charter of government by the people of America. As Governor Edmund Randolph of Virginia described it, the Confederation Congress was a mere diplomatic body and always obsequious to the views of the states. Consistent with the primacy of the states, the Articles established neither executive officers nor courts. Congress managed all public business through its clumsy one-vote-per-state rule. Few governments in history, and none of any duration, have so disdained the executive and judicial functions. Indeed, in 1787, no American state followed that peculiar one-branch structure. Every state constitution provided for an executive and a court system. Only the national government lacked those essential offices. The powers that Congress actually possessed, declaring war, entering into treaties, coining and borrowing money, could be exercised only with the votes of 9 states. Because absenteeism was rife, only infrequently were that many states present in Congress. As a final guarantee of state supremacy, the Articles could be amended only if all 13 state legislatures agreed, a requirement that doomed attempts to empower Congress to impose taxes or enforce treaty provisions. The weakness of the Confederation Congress, combined with the practical impossibility of amending the Articles, meant that many delegates in Philadelphia agreed with Madison and Washington that America needed a new government with energy. One New England delegate lamented the Confederation's deranged condition, while another warned that without action, the present phantom of a government must soon expire. At Madison's prodding, Virginia was first to answer the call to the Philadelphia Convention. The reluctant Washington stood at the top of its delegate list, followed by Madison, George Mason, and Governor Edmund Randolph. In all, 12 states appointed 74 delegates to the convention. Rhode Island's populist leaders, understanding that the convention was intended to eliminate their right to issue paper money, refused to participate. Washington did not lament Rhode Island's absence, though he bewailed that state's scandalous conduct, which seems to have marked all her public councils of late. Only 55 of the appointed delegates actually made it to Philadelphia, and no more than 30 attended the full 4 months of the deliberations. Notable omissions from the delegate list were John Adams and Thomas Jefferson, who were serving as ministers to Britain and France, respectively. Just as important, several opponents of a stronger national government did not attend. The absence of states' rights advocates like Samuel Adams of Massachusetts and Patrick Henry of Virginia, who said he smelt a rat in the call to the convention, would make consensus easier to reach. Most of the delegates had served the new nation before. 8 signed the Declaration of Independence, 15 helped draft their state constitutions, and 25 were members of the Continental Congress during the Revolution. Almost 3/4 of them had served in the Confederation Congress since 1781, so they knew firsthand the frustrations of governing under the Articles. The delegates' distinction led Jefferson to exclaim in a letter to Adams, "It really is an assembly of demigods." On the eve of the convention, Washington and Madison each drew on images of collapse and destruction. "The present system neither has nor deserves..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.